Welcome into the Save Saturdays podcast. I'm Ethan Petrick, coming from the Save Saturdays studio in Lincoln. As always, joined in the studio today by Big Bets Bentz, Ryan, and Will Reason. We'll be leaving the show a little early today, but Ryan and I are going to keep it rocking with a little NASCAR and a fantasy football update from all of us, I hope. We'll see. How you guys doing today?
It's all right.
Yeah, not bad. It's a bit chilly, a little rainy outside, but...
Yeah. Not a fan.
Yeah. I stan a cold weather because that means I can wear my flannels.
Yeah.
That is... Yeah, that's true.
Flannel, sweater weather now.
That's right. Sweater weather.
It's always flannel season, though, no matter how...
That's true.
Hot or cold.
I mean, if it's 100 degrees outside... I would sweat just putting the flannel on.
Better
so.
Believe I'm wearing a flannel. I'm still wearing the flannel.
I'd get halfway through the buttons and I'd just be dying. But that is not the question of the week. It's not what kind of weather we like. The question of the week this week is, what is, in your opinion, the greatest sports movie of all time?
Ryan, you going to start?
Nope. Go for
all
it.
All right, I'll start it.
Yes, you will.
Who will? I will?
Yes,
I'm starting?
Yes,
okay.
You will. Who will. You will.
Well, you said, yes, you will. And your point doesn't matter. There's a lot of great options. A lot of Kevin Costner movies, because he just seems to be in every sports movie ever made. But not in this one. I'm going with Rudy. The Notre Dame football star, not really a star. Solid movie.
Not bad.
So the guy who plays Rudy, he's actually in Stranger Things, and he's like this chubby guy. And he, spoiler alert, if you haven't seen like this, the second season of Stranger Things, which has been out for like 3 years now, but he gets like murked by some like devil demon dog things.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. I didn't even know he was Rudy until like I watched a video about that Stranger Things episode, and they were like, poor Rudy. I'm like, oh, what? And so I looked it up, and yeah, he plays Rudy.
Oh, well, I've never seen Stranger Things. You know Vince Vaughn is in Stranger Things. He's in Rudy.
I didn't know
he
that.
He plays one of the starters in like at Notre Dame.
Well, I should tell you about Notre Dame's athletes Rudy. At that point.
If their athletes are Vince Vaughn, yeah, no kidding. That's where he got his start.
My turn?
Yeah.
All right. Talladega Nights.
Okay. There's so many good sports.
I know.
It's so hard to pick.
I know, right?
Talladega Nights is great.
It's a great comedy movie.
Talladega Nights,
of course, right? NASCAR. Will Ferrell. I love Will Ferrell. He's a funny guy.
My mom hates Will Ferrell.
He's not for everybody.
I don't know why. Yeah. But yeah, he really isn't. His comedy. Yeah.
Kind of same with Steve Carell, but that's a different story.
I mean, is Steve Carell really that hard to find funny? I think it depends on the role he's playing.
I think you can say that about anyone, though.
Well, I feel like
The problem with Will Ferrell is he plays the same role for about everything.
That's what I'm saying. So somebody like Will Ferrell or like Adam Sandler, they're going to play the same character in every movie that they're in. Mm-hmm. But Steve Carell, he's a little more diverse.
Right.
He plays Michael Scott. He plays the 40-year-old virgin.
Rumsfeld and Vice. Have you seen that one?
I have not.
No. That's a really good movie. He actually plays his role in that very good. I mean, he's actually hilarious.
He's also the voice of Gru in Despicable Me.
Yes.
So, I mean, significantly more diverse actor.
I think we're just saying that Steve Carell's just better than Will Ferrell at everything.
Well, I mean...
When did this turn into a Will Ferrell roast session?
Don't come after my king. Don't come after my king, Michael Scott. And we're not going to have any issues.
No one was coming after him.
Nope.
It kind of sounded like it.
Michael Scott.
We all love Steve Carell.
He probably has the best role in comedy television series ever.
I think that's indisputable.
I think it's very safe to say The Office died when Michael Scott left.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Oh,
it was
okay.
Not the same.
I have to say, I do like Robert California.
Really?
Yeah. I'm blanking on his name.
The actor's name?
Yeah.
I don't know who.
I can see his face.
Yeah.
I was not a
James
fan.
Spade.
James Spade?
Yeah, or Spader. I don't remember. James Spader.
What you doing over there, Ethan?
Yeah, it's Spader.
I'm importing new sounds for the podcast because I forgot.
All right.
Do you want to give us your sports movie?
There we go. Yeah, I just got all of the new ones put in. So I played hockey in high school. For
just
my
a entire self-plug.
My entire youth, actually. I played hockey. I do the sport, the hockey podcast for the Safe Saturdays Podcast Network, SSPN. So I think it's pretty obvious that what I'm about to say.
What, Mighty Ducks?
Exactly. You read my mind. Mighty Ducks, Goldberg, favorite. No, it's going to be a miracle. Yeah. Let's talk about a really inspirational movie. I feel like this depends on if you're American or not, because it's definitely an American story as well.
Absolutely.
So it's just another sports hockey movie if you're not from America. But if you are from America, it just means a little bit more. I think it's hard to not get hyped by that speech at the end, you know?
Yeah, that's probably the greatest hype speech of all time, not going to lie.
Yeah, so as a hockey player, sit in the locker room, throw your headphones on, listen to that speech, you know?
Yeah.
Gets you hype. You know, just switch out the Soviets for X team you're playing, and you're ready to go.
You were going to actually say Mighty Ducks.
Herb Brooks. I was actually going to make that joke, but then you stole the joke from me.
Oh, my bad.
It's all right. No worries. Moving on, shifting over to our first topic. As always, NFL. I'd say the biggest news of the NFL in this past week is that Yannick Ngakoue, today, Thursday, just got traded from the Minnesota Vikings to the Baltimore Ravens.
For a bag of chips and some Gatorade.
essentially what the Vikings did is they traded a second-round pick, because they traded a second and a fifth for Yannick Ngakoue to the Jags in August. They traded a second-round pick for three sacks, and then immediately traded those three sacks. They traded Yannick Ngakoue to the Ravens for a third, and they got the fifth back. So they lost a round on their pick, mm-hmm. and they basically just paid three sacks for it. They got three sacks for it.
Yeah.
Was that worth it, given their current situation?
No.
Was there a dispute there, like, between the organization, between Ngakoue, or what?
I think they just realized that they're not, like, he wants to compete. He's on the franchise tag. Probably aren't going to be able to convince him to come back. So at this point, they were probably just trying to recoup their losses. Mm. And to only lose a round like that is probably the best they could have done. Yeah. Especially getting that fifth back. I think that was pretty big. Mm-hmm. Obviously, both those picks are going to be at the bottoms of their respective rounds. And a Vikings pick would be at the top at this point, given that they're a one-win team. And I originally thought that the Vikings, both teams won, because I thought that the Vikings had only given up a third-round pick. But given that they gave up a second-round pick, that's a player you could expect to start right away.
Right.
Some notable players, Antoine Winfield Jr., he went in the second round this last year. Real, real big player for Will's favorite team, the Minnesota Golden Gophers.
And then went to the Bucks with Tom Brady.
Yep.
Dude's just a champ. Speaking of the Ravens, too, did you see Dez Bryant signed to their practice squad?
He was signed to the practice squad?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't see that he got signed to the practice squad. I saw that they were going to work him
Ravens
out.
Ravens are making moves right now.
Their receiving core is kind of weak. Mark Andrews not having a repeat season. Marquise Brown did not make the jump that I think a lot of people in Baltimore were expecting. So this could be a pretty nice little splash signing.
When you have a run game and a defense like that, like, you can't everything can't be great. And Marquise Brown has been all right. I have him on fantasy, and he has not been bad at all. Like,
he hasn't been bad, but he hasn't taken the step that they were looking for. He's basically the same player he was last year.
Well, if you were expecting him to be Tyreek Hill, then yeah, but I don't think anyone would do that from year one to year two.
He's their number one receiver, he's not a top 10 number one receiver in the NFL.
Well, no, but he's only his second year, and I don't think a lot of second year guys are ever.
I think they were really betting on him to make that kind of step, though. To be in that, like, Tyreek Hill.
But he did take a step. He took a step up, I'd say.
How about Calvin Ridley? What year is he?
He's got to be in, what, 4 or 5?
Really?
He's with the Falcons.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what are you trying to say?
I thought he was, like, a second or third year guy.
Yeah, he's in his third year, I think. Second or third year.
Okay. He's been in more than two.
I feel.
Who knows? I have no idea.
I'm not big on the Falcons' number two receiver. Notably, Julio Jones. There's rumors that Matt Ryan and Julio Jones might be on the move. If Julio Jones, arguably the number one receiver in the NFL, got his first touchdown this last Sunday, where would you like to see him go? Will, you can't say the Patriots, and I'm not going to say the Packers. Ryan, I don't think you'd even say the Cowboys because they have plenty of weapons.
Oh, of course not.
So, Where are you guys thinking that you would like to see Julio Jones play?
Houston Texans.
He Ethan doesn't like that.
Why not?
Why would you continue to waste his career with a dumpster, like just trade him to another dumpster fire organization? Plus, the Texans don't even have the draft capital to make that kind of move. They'd essentially have to trade Deshaun Watson to the Falcons. That's their only movable asset.
How about the Bears?
I would hate to see it as a Packers fan, but yeah. I would also hate to see it given that no one's capable of throwing the ball to even Allen Robinson.
Right.
But it'd be an interesting move. Definitely make the Bears a better team. Mm-hmm. I would like to see him go to Philadelphia. I think that'd be Carson Wentz wouldn't have an excuse after that. Because right now his excuse is that
I think he's run out of excuses already.
Yeah. Well, his top receiver
definitely wouldn't then.
His top receiver is Travis Fulgham. He was a walk-on at Old Dominion, undrafted rookie, and he's their top receiver right now.
Huh.
Ertz is taking a huge step back this season. I mean, if they get Julio Jones and Fulgham can move there too, it drastically improves that offense.
It's true. And Calvin Ridley is in his third year, by the way.
Yeah.
This is his third year.
Yeah, I looked
that
up.
That's what I thought.
Also. Yeah. Yeah,
so, that's it. what was your final answer? Texans?
The Bears.
The Bears? Yeah. I don't know. At this point, I feel realistic. Like he'd go to the Chiefs. Somehow. He would somehow get signed by the Chiefs.
Or the Ravens.
But, crap, I don't know.
Seahawks?
That would be cool. That would be really cool.
They're already so deep. They have Tyler Lockett, DK Metcalf.
You move someone then. You get rid of Greg Olsen.
That would be
Jones, the kind of player that you move someone to bring on.
That'd be a scary offense.
Greg Olsen's injury prone, anyways.
Yeah, he's old. Also have Will Disley. Who, I don't think he's back from his injury he suffered last year, but Disley was coming on early last season, then had that tough injury. Little plug. He is from Montana, so clearly he's above average, and beyond the rest of
average. Sure.
What do you got against Montana?
Nothing.
Better than these corn-fed?
Nothing. Montana's great.
That's what I thought. That is what I thought. I would like to see Julio Jones play for... Pausing for suspense. The Pittsburgh Steelers.
Ooh. That actually did cross my mind.
Because
for a second,
you guys already know, I don't really think Juju's like a legit number one. I think he's like a 1B kind of guy, you know. I think he's like a Jarvis Landry to an Odell Beckham. You know, they're both really good receivers.
Okay.
But they're not going to be ones on high-powered offenses. And that is not, the Steelers have not been a high-powered offense this year. And they've shown a willingness to go out and throw a first-round pick at a star player to bring in more talent with Minkah Fitzpatrick. So, what's stopping the Steelers, the Roonies, from throwing a couple high-round picks at the Falcons for a Julio Jones, bring him in? Then they have James Conner, Julio Jones, Eric Ebron, Smith-Schuster, Big Ben, and then whoever they bring in to replace Big Ben whenever he retires. I think that's going to be a super high-powered offense. That would basically ensure that they're going to be competitive while Julio Jones is still in his prime. So I would like to see him in a Steelers uniform, even though I'm not a very big Steelers fan.
That'd be cool. I'd like to see that.
Yeah.
And then real quick, Will's got to leave real soon here, but do you still think Josh Allen, top three quarterback, after two back-to-back losses and two anemic performances, specifically this weekend where he only went for 122 yards and a touchdown, I believe?
He's definitely dropped on the list. But I'm still on the Josh Allen train. The dude's going to pick it up. The season's not over. We're not even halfway through the season yet. Here's my thing. I just watched Aaron Rodgers play the worst game of his season. Mm-hmm. But I still think Aaron Rodgers is a top three quarterback. I think he'll end up being one. So just because they have a couple bad games, I'm not jumping off the ship. I'm staying on.
Do you feel better about me saying that Tom Brady's a top five quarterback? Because last episode, I said that, and you were like, ooh.
Well, I mean...
He had a pretty good game.
He had a very good game. I mean, I don't know. He had... the whole Bucs team just had a great game. Like, I wouldn't say Tom Brady led them to that win. I mean, Aaron Rodgers threw a pick six. Ronald Jones played pretty good. Like, it was a team effort. Yeah.
Mike Evans didn't play good at all.
Sounds like a little fantasy update.
That's
there.
Right. A little bit. A little sneaky.
He's a little
peek.
Salty.
So what team did you say, Will?
I like the Seahawks idea. I'm gonna go with that one. That'd be really cool. I didn't even think that'd be awesome.
Both top teams in the NFC and AFC getting spoken for here on the Julio Jones.
That'd be just
market.
That'd be fun to watch.
Certainly hope he doesn't get wasted in Houston, Ryan.
That was just yeah. This is a fun pick. That was just a fun pick.
You know who has moved in the top five? Ryan Tannehill.
Thank you.
What do you mean thank you?
Thank you.
I've been on the Ryan Tannehill
I said he was sixth last week, and you were like freaking out
last
on me.
Week?
Yeah.
I was on the Ryan Tannehill train way before last week.
That's true.
I just didn't have him in my top five yet. Now, after Josh Allen's performance and Aaron Rodgers kind of slipping up, I would definitely put him in the top five so far. That can change.
Well, as we say goodbye to Will, we'll take a quick break so he can skedaddle.
Bye.
Bye, Will.
Well, it's nice having you for 16 minutes.
Don't mess the rest of the show up.
No problem.
Well, give him something good. We're definitely not now that you're heading out.
Yeah, it's about to get a lot better.
And we're back with the second half of the first segment, talking all things NFL. Ryan and I got a little fun game in store for you guys, starting right now.
Oh, yeah, I'm excited.
Playing a little game I like to call Panic, Don't Panic.
Yep.
And we'll be telling you if it's time for these NFL teams to panic. Or if they just need to relax.
Relax.
You know, in the words of Aaron Rodgers, R-E-L-A-X, relax.
Yeah.
So, without further ado, we'll kick it off right now with the Buffalo Bills. Ryan, two consecutive losses. Josh Allen has not looked good in either of them, as we just mentioned. Is it time to panic or not panic?
I think it's time to not panic for the Bills. Although Josh,
Sheriff, this is no time to panic.
Yeah, there you go. although Josh Allen has had a couple rough games, I think he'll brush it off. And they play the Jets this weekend, so I think that's a very good comeback game for them. They get their mojo back together. Josh Allen throws a few dimes, three touchdowns, maybe three or four. I don't know. We'll see. But I think it's time. I don't think they need to panic here.
I'm gonna go ahead and agree with you and say,
Sheriff, this is no time to panic.
It's no time to panic for the Buffalo Bills. You know, they looked hot through the first couple games, and they ran into a buzzsaw in the Tennessee Titans, arguably the second best team in the NFL.
Yeah.
Maybe the best team in the NFL.
Maybe.
They definitely have the best running back in the NFL, and Derrick Henry.
That's for sure.
So I would say, Bills, don't panic. You get the Jets.
Yeah.
If you don't win that game,
then
it's time to panic. But
right.
I think it's going to be smooth sailing for the Bills to the playoffs. Still expect them to win the division for sure.
Absolutely, without a doubt.
How about let's shift to the complete opposite coast.
Yeah.
How are we feeling about the San Francisco 49ers? Is it time to panic? They've had a lot of injuries. Jimmy Garoppolo has not looked good.
I think it's time to panic on this one.
This is the perfect time to panic.
Yeah, for sure. Injuries have been keeping them out of kind of contending with the other teams. And Raheem Mostert just got hurt again. I think a high calf sprain, maybe.
Yeah, he's going to go on the IR for a little bit, I think I read.
Yeah, it's not good, especially for my fantasy team. But that'll come at a different time. But, injuries are just keeping them out of the game, I think. And when they keep kind of racking up these injuries, then time to panic for those guys.
Well, I don't think it's time to panic.
This is no time to panic.
Okay.
It's no time to panic for the Niners. They just beat a really successful team in the Los Angeles Rams this last week. You know, they stayed within themselves. They played a game they knew they could win. Mm-hmm. And they came out on top. So I don't, if I'm a Niners fan, I'm breathing. It might be a little short.
Sure.
A little nervous. We're right there on the edge, but we're good. We're good for now. We're good for now.
All right.
49ers are a team that they're on a bye. Actually, they're playing the Patriots this week. Okay. That might be time of panic, but, other than that, I'm not too concerned about where this 49ers team is sitting right now. They still have their coach. They have a good number of contributors from last year. They're a little weak on that defensive line, but I think it's going to end up all right. Jerick McKinnon is,
he's solid backup.
He's their number one, I think.
Okay.
They really like Jerick McKinnon. You hear a lot of this offseason. They were happy to have him back after he had a season-ending injury last year. So,
right.
I think that Raheem Mostert certainly had a great postseason. But I don't think he was even the number one coming into the season.
Okay. All
right. Moving right along, is it time to panic in a good way for the Miami Dolphins? They announced Tua Tagovailoa is the starting quarterback. They've had a couple of wins, two straight wins, in fact. They are 3-3 sitting right at 500. Is it time to excitedly panic that you might finally have a good team in Miami?
I'd say the Miami Dolphins should. I think they should panic on this one.
This is the perfect time to panic.
Rookie quarterback Tua getting starting role. Coming from college, Tua is obviously a really good quarterback. He's played a couple snaps already this season, but starting, I don't know. It kind of puts a little bit of pressure on him, although the Dolphins are looking pretty good. And Ryan Fitzpatrick, he was having really good games. And
He threw three touchdowns and two interceptions. I wouldn't call that exceptional football. I wouldn't say it was a really good game. He had a winning performance is what I would say. He won the game, and they were playing the Jets, so it doesn't take too much to beat the Jets.
That's a fair point. I think it's definitely going to be interesting to see where the Dolphins take Tua from here and where the Tua takes the Dolphins from here. So,
well, I think you took my what I was saying a little bit different. You think it's time to panic because they should be nervous that they're getting a little too ahead of their skis, is what you're saying.
Yeah, in a way.
Okay.
I don't know. This is nervous panic for me.
It's a nervous panic. I was saying panic in a good way. Like,
right.
Do you finally have a good team? And I'm going to go ahead and say it is time to
this
panic.
This is the perfect time to panic.
Because you got a coach who, you know, they came on the last five games last year. They beat the New England Patriots, keeping them out of the number one seed in the playoffs last year. Showed a lot of heart, a lot of grit, determination at the end of last season. Coming into this season, slow start, but they played a lot of good teams tough.
Yeah.
Narrow loss to the New England Patriots. Very close loss to the Seattle Seahawks, who are currently leading the NFC as one of two remaining undefeated teams. And then on top of that, just obliterate a 49ers team that was in the Super Bowl last year. Yeah, I think it's time to get excited, time to panic, you know?
Right.
You don't know what this is like, Miami. Go crazy. You guys have a good team.
Exactly.
I think you got a good coach. I like Brian Flores. I wish the Packers would have hired him instead of LaFleur.
Ooh.
But Miami got him, so congratulations, Miami.
Yeah. You're in for one heck of a – well, it's bye week this weekend, but that'll give him more time to prepare. So, yeah, we'll see.
Transitioning back to the traditional definitions of our panic, don't panic. The Green Bay Packers, previously undefeated, go into a game against the Bucks. I think many were expecting them to win. They're off a bye, a little extra time to prep, and it was a dud. Laid an egg. They looked hot out the gate, went up 10-0, and it was all Bucks from there, scoring 38 unanswered points to win 38-10. Mm-hmm. Aaron Rodgers throwing two picks.
Yeah,
in the game.
Not his game, for sure.
So is it time to panic if you're a Green Bay Packers fan, or?
Absolutely not.
Sheriff, this is no time to panic.
Although Aaron Rodgers had a rough game. I mean, you're going to see every great quarterback have a rough game. And it was at Tampa Bay. So tough, playing against a tough crowd there, home crowd there. And I mean, you're up against Tom Brady, another great quarterback. And, I think, I don't know, I can't read minds, but maybe Aaron Rodgers is just putting a little more pressure on himself, and that pressure got to him. But,
well, actually going into the game, I think around Thursday or Friday, a story came out that Aaron Rodgers said that he's not really concerned about playing against Tom Brady. He's worried about playing against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers defense. So I think he was mentally,
okay.
I think he was a little afraid.
Of the defense?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see that.
I'm not questioning his mental fortitude or anything like that, but
of course.
I think he went in expecting something bad to happen, and when you have that kind of mentality, something's bad
exactly.
will happen.
Exactly.
And so when I saw that quote, I was like,
okay. Shut up! Just shut up, you idiot!
I don't want to hear my quarterback say that. That doesn't inspire confidence. If you're one of his fellow offensive starters and you see your quarterback go out and say that, are you like, does he not have faith in us? What's the deal? Like,
right. Yeah.
I'm all for the confidence. Jamal Williams, the backup running back.
Four carries.
I wasn't gonna say anything about a stat line, but I was just gonna say he goes out there and he talks some smack on Tom Brady. I like that. That got the fan base fired up.
Yeah.
I'm sure that got players in the locker room fired up. Probably takes a couple of them off, like, hey, what are you doing? Giving them bulletin board material. But I like that over whatever it was Aaron Rodgers was doing.
Right. And going back to the stats, right? So for rushing, they've only carried the ball 21 times. And when you have Aaron Jones, Jamal Williams as backup, I think you'd want to maybe utilize those guys a little more.
Aaron, all the running backs had a bad game.
Yeah.
The front seven in Tampa is highly, highly underrated. I mean,
Sue,
Shaq Barrett, Lamonte David.
Gerald McCoy.
Another Husker. Gerald McCoy does not play for the Buccaneers.
My bad.
Devin White. And then Vita Vea. So,
oh, yeah. Vita Vea.
I mean, all of those guys are very skilled players. Yeah. I'm not going to say that they're all destined for a Pro Bowl this year, but those are guys you don't want to face regularly. If they're in your division, you're having to at least focus on them in film. You look at the Packers defensive line, Tyler Lancaster. No one cares about Tyler Lancaster. You know you're going to take care of that guy. You don't need to do anything special in the film room to be like, hey, you see when this guy does this, this is what we need to do. Or hey, on the practice field, this is how you need to block him this weekend. You need to make sure you take care of this guy. No, you don't have to do that about Tyler Lancaster. You have to do that about all of those guys for Tampa Bay. So when you're dealing with that, especially with two athletic middle linebackers in White and David that can play coverage as well, it's a difficult defense to play against them. So I'm looking for a confidence building quotes prior to the game, not what Rodgers said. Mm-hmm. So very irritated. But
well, what do you think?
I hated the quote, but
yeah. Sheriff, this is no time to panic.
Right. It's no time to panic. We're fine. I think we're better than every team in the division. That's going to be at least 3 more wins. So, well, actually, it'll be 4 more wins if we win every game in the division for the rest of the way out. So that'll get us to 8-8 at least. So that's good enough to make the playoffs, because clearly the NFC East isn't even gonna win 5 games. None of them are gonna win 5 games.
Yeah, I don't think so.
So I like the Packers' chances. I'm not panicking yet. If the Bears take the Packers down in the first meeting, I'm gonna panic. But until then, I'm relaxed.
Yeah.
I'm chill. I'm chill.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
And to our beloved NFC East, the premier example of what is football in America. Just kidding. Is it time to panic if you're a Dallas Cowboys fan?
Yes, absolutely.
This is the perfect time to panic.
Dak Prescott, very bad injury, ankle injury, out for season. Andy Dalton, backup quarterback, not kind of finding his groove there with the Cowboys. Struggling on offense. Running game has been all right, but passing game has been awful. And I think it's definitely time for Cowboys to panic.
I also thought it was interesting that going into that game, I'm not sure who said it. I'm not sure if it was Dalton who said it or McCarthy who said it. One of those two said that the Cowboys will not change their offense for Andy Dalton. They're going to keep what they were doing with Dak Prescott. Mm. But you look at those two quarterbacks, they're significantly different quarterbacks.
Yeah.
I don't even think that Dalton has the arm strength that of Dak.
Absolutely not.
So I think there's a significantly different thing you need to do with Dalton, mm-hmm. as opposed to with Prescott. And when you look at the Cowboys and they're running a pass-happy offense with Prescott, mm-hmm. you got Zeke. Just run through Zeke. Zeke is a Pro Bowl caliber player. Andy Dalton is not. He was at one point. He's not anymore.
Yep.
There's a reason why he was your backup.
I think the Cowboys should – I mean, they have a ton of wideout weapons. And, I mean, when you see Elliott carry the ball only 12 times, and Elliott, one of the better running backs in the league, you need to give him the ball more.
Well, I think you see a lot of people talking about, like, you know, what's wrong with Ezekiel Elliott? What's going on this year? Well, it's simple. He's just not getting touches. He can't get into his rhythm. He has no rhythm this year. He had a down year last year, because he missed training camp. Now this year's COVID, shortened training camp, and the new coach just refuses to use him. Zeke should be getting at least 20 carries a game.
Oh, at least.
12 should never happen. 12 should be only happen when he's done in the first half.
Exactly.
He should be up 42-0 at halftime, and Zeke doesn't touch the ball for the rest of the game because he's sitting on the bench, not because you refuse to give him the ball. And I understand you're playing from behind, but just rhythm, get your offensive in a rhythm by giving it to Zeke, let him get 6 yards per carry as he did his rookie season in the NFL.
And then when you start running the ball more, the defense shifts to the running game, and that way you can start passing a little bit.
Opens up the play action, yeah.
Exactly.
Mike McCarthy has done a terrible job as the head coach of the Dallas Cowboys pretty much since day one.
I agree.
So, yeah, it is time to panic if you're the Dallas Cowboys. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't see another game they can win.
And finally, division rival of those Dallas Cowboys, is it time for the Philadelphia Eagles to panic?
Yes, for sure.
This is the perfect time to panic.
I mean, at one point they're leading the division 1-4-1, having that tied game, but I mean, I haven't seen any improvement. I mean, what's his name? Carson Wentz. He hasn't shown up at all. I don't know. There's not much for me to say other than panic.
I disagree.
Mm. Sheriff, this is no time to panic.
Why panic when you are decimated by injury? As I said before, your leading receiver is Travis Fulgham. Shout out on my fantasy team. Please do good this weekend. I'm begging you. But your leading receiver is Travis Fulgham. Zach Ertz, somebody you thought you could rely on as a receiver. Carson Wentz's favorite receiver. Having a terrible game, not getting targeted, just can't get open. Something's wrong there. Offensive line 2 years ago was your strength. Now they can't block a piece of Swiss cheese. They're looking like a piece of Swiss cheese. So, yes, there are some alarming things, but I don't think it's time to panic because all these things are going wrong for them, but they're still right there. If they win two games, they're leading the division. So,
right. Okay.
It's until the Dallas Cowboys figure out how to separate themselves or the Giants or the Washington football team figure out how to separate themselves from the rest of the pack, I don't think it's time for the Eagles to panic. I understand that they look on paper, both teams, similar records. Why are the Dallas Cowboys panicking and the Eagles are not? I look at the Dallas Cowboys and I see a lot of weapons and I see what they were doing with their starting quarterback with all those weapons. It was nothing. But Carson Wentz hasn't had his weapons all season and they're still right in it. So Eagles, don't panic. Cowboys, panic.
Yeah.
All right, Ryan, you've been antsy. It's the fantasy football update. Give us a little quick update.
Of course. So I won last week. I'm now 4-2, third in the league. Not doing too shabby. I should say tied for third, but nah. So I've had the Miami Dolphins. They're on their bye week, so I had to boot them off my team. And I also had the kicker, Jason Sanders, Miami. But he's doing real well this season. Not missing any of his field goals. No, not missing any of his extra points. So I decided to hang on to him, and then pick up Randy Bullock with the Bengals. So other than that, Mostert injured. That stinks. But I got his backup, Jerick McKinnon.
It's not his backup. That's the starter.
Well, now he's the starter.
Definitely the starter. He's the only one left.
What? Exactly.
I'm pretty sure Jermichael Hasty, the undrafted rookie out of Baylor, is also injured. So it's Jerick McKinnon's basically the only experienced back left.
He'll get a ton of touches this weekend. Hopefully rack up some points for me.
I'm trying to trade for him in fantasy right now, so hopefully.
Really?
Hopefully that person's not been paying attention.
In my league?
No.
Of course not.
What, you think I'd offer you a trade and then tell you I offered you a trade?
Maybe.
No.
Okay. Are your other leagues like paid payout leagues?
Yeah, I win money if I do successful. Okay.
I was gonna say, why aren't you paying attention to the league I'm in?
I do pay attention to that league. I'm just not trying to trade for him in that league. I already beat you, so I'm already better than you.
Let's not bring that up. Oh, what's your record then?
What's my record? Shot? I think like 2-4, 2-5.
I'm 4-2. So.
Yeah. Well, all that matters is the head to head.
I just definitely had the wrong players, and if I had the right players, then I would have beat you.
What way to sum up every fantasy game ever? Well, I had the wrong players in, but if I had the right players, I would have won. I think very rarely is it that just simply you could not win because you didn't have the players. I think almost always there's a player on your bench that goes off that you didn't have pegged to go off.
Yeah,
so
safe to say. Anyways, I got Eagles defense. They're playing tonight, Thursday night, against the Giants. Should see a good payout of points there in that game. And I decided to start Matt Ryan, keep Minshew on my bench. Matt Ryan plays Detroit. So, yeah, other than that, Derrick Henry, Aaron Jones, got really good running backs. Aaron Jones plays Houston, the worst running defense in the league. So, I'm not worried this week. Not worried at all.
For me, I actually did very well in one of my leagues. Two players... both didn't play in their games, and I had no choice but to play them because I didn't have time to pick up a new tight end.
Right.
No offense, it's my tight end. He gets put. He's out. He's not playing.
Uh-huh.
Leonard Fournette. I only have three running backs on my roster, and it's a 12-team league with multiple, a plethora of bench spots. The best running back I have left to pick up, I just picked up, it was Jamal Williams, the backup running back for Green Bay. Not exactly a fantasy stud.
No.
Second best, Frank Gore. Yeah, no thanks. I don't need a 50-year-old man on my fantasy team. So no one really to pick up. So I just, and I didn't want to drop anybody for any of the garbage that was was available.
So you played without two players.
So I played. I got two fat zeros in my starting lineup. Still came away with the dub.
No.
Started the Miami Dolphins defense. Got 30 points from them. Justin Jefferson, 31 points from him.
Yeah.
So that's 61 points right there.
I made up.
I only needed him and my kicker to win, actually. Those two and my kicker to win. So, yeah.
That's impressive.
I was feeling myself. Everything else was just a little dressing.
Yeah. All right.
Started Drew Lock over Joe Burrow. Ended up being a bad decision.
Oh, man. Yeah.
But Drew Lock did end up, he led the Broncos to a dub, didn't he? Beat the Patriots.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah. So, clearly.
Good win for Drew Block.
Drew Block. Real nice win for Drew Block. Speaking of blocking, it's a very common theme in NASCAR. Joey Logano, great blocker. Why do I bring that up? Because our very next segment coming up after this commercial break is about NASCAR. Ryan, how about you give us a little taste of what you will mainly be talking about, and I will be adding a little bit. It'll be a little mini version of
Drive
the Greens.
But. So when we get back, I got a little Denny Hamlin, Michael Jordan racing team information there. They figured out their team name, so I'll be excited to share that with you. Also, Kyle Larson, the former driver, NASCAR driver in the 42, got reinstated. And we'll talk more about Joey Logano locking into the Championship Four after a win at Kansas. And then I'll come back with you this week at Texas.
Hey, Save Saturdays listeners. It's Ethan Petrick with a special announcement. Airing every Tuesday at 2 p.m., Takeout Tuesday is a show all about food. Join in as Will and I try different restaurants, finding out which restaurants are superstars and which are undraftable. We don't hold back as we tell you what's good and what isn't. Make sure to subscribe to Save Saturdays on YouTube so you don't miss a single episode. And as always, Save Saturdays. And we're back for the third segment. We had a little brief break as we said goodbye to Will, let him get out the door without making too much noise on the air, quotation marks, because we're not live. But yeah, so we're doing something we haven't done before here on the Save Saturdays OG podcast.
Very exciting.
We're giving Ryan Big Bentz the floor on NASCAR. We're giving him a whole segment. We normally just save it for his little bets at the end. Yeah. His big little bets. But sure. we're giving him a solid 20, 30 minutes here. So,
oh boy, that's a lot of time.
I'm just kidding. Take all the time you need, or as little time as you need. Right. But Ryan, it's nearly time for the Championship Four. So
yeah, really good time. My favorite part of the season, round of eight. And right now, drivers racing in the Championship Four now. So what I'll start with here in this NASCAR segment, and I have to say, Ethan, thank you very much for giving me the room here. It's an honor. So, all right. Michael Jordan, if you haven't heard already, Michael Jordan, that basketball star, teamed up with Denny Hamlin, and they're going to create a new NASCAR team known as 23X. I racing. So 23, of course, Michael Jordan's number, and 23 will be the number on the car. Bubba Wallace will be driving, and the XI, you might wonder, well, what's significance about the XI?
I think I have a good guess.
Sure.
Actually, you know what? I changed my mind.
No, say it.
Nah, I had something because I forgot that X was 10, and I thought it was 5. So I thought it was six. I was like, oh, so many rings Michael Jordan won. But that is clearly wrong because my Roman numerals, I lost them. And I got them back. And I'm like, dang, you're an idiot.
you're on the right track. Ah, insight or pun. No pun included. XI, no Roman numerals for 11. And that is Denny Hamlin's number.
That was not even close to six rings.
Well, Denny Hamlin's number 11, so XI. Yeah, Roman numerals for 11. So I thought that was kind of interesting.
You want to know what that last segment just was? That's me right there. Yeah. I'm just a little clown, you know.
You clown.
Yeah, I should have played. I should have played that while I was talking because I'm an idiot. I knew I was messing up as I was saying it. It's like a train wreck in slow motion.
Oh yeah, hate to see it.
Really quite embarrassing. All right, go ahead, Ryan.
So Denny Hamlin will still race for Joe Gibbs Racing next season. So very exciting for Bubba Wallace to team up with NBA legend Jordan and a 3-time Daytona 500 winner, Denny Hamlin. Here's what Hamlin had to say. Michael and I have shared vision for this team, so it's exciting to see it reflected in the team name and on the race car with the iconic number 23 that Michael made famous. And yeah, I agree. A very iconic number. Not as iconic as that number 3, of course, Dale Earnhardt Sr., but maybe we'll see 23 become iconic in NASCAR as well. So, and 23XI Racing, new Twitter page, of course. Their post on Twitter already amassed over 10,000 followers. So that's also kind of fun to see. Definitely good to see for the NASCAR community, you know, get some more viewers. And then Bubba Wallace is the only African-American driver at the Cup level and has spent his entirety of his NASCAR Cup Series career with Richard Petty Motorsports, driving in that 43 car. And also, some breaking news, Eric Jones, former Joe Gibbs, he's current Joe Gibbs racer in that number 20 car, will replace Richard Petty Motorsports in that 43 car next season. So, let's see what Michael Jordan has to say. Growing up in North Carolina, my parents would take my brothers, sisters, and me to races. And I've been a NASCAR fan my whole life. Would you have ever thought NBA legend Michael Jordan attend NASCAR races in his youth and be a NASCAR fan his whole life? I would have never guessed. But
you don't think he's just saying that to get the fans hype?
Could be. Also, Jordan said the opportunity to own my own racing team in partnership with my friend Denny Hamlin. And to have Bubba Wallace driving for us is very exciting for me. Historically, NASCAR has struggled with diversity, and there have been a few black owners. Well, now there will be an African-American owner next season.
There will be one more.
One more to the list. So definitely excited. I'm excited to see where this team will go. They're definitely going to have the resources to make a good car. Bubba Wallace has been a decent driver this year. And with the resources Bubba will have next season, I think he'll be a contender for the playoffs. So a very exciting season ahead for Bubba Wallace.
I'm just going to go out on a limb and say that our viewers, our listeners, don't necessarily know what a racing team is. So could you maybe explain that whole deal to them? Because I am not 100% sure on it.
So a racing team, so you have like Team Penske. Roger Penske is the president, and he actually just recently bought out Indianapolis Motor Speedway. So Team Penske is probably one of the, of course, better teams and more like definitely has the access to resources to win races, and we've seen that in the past, of course. So basically there's also Joe Gibbs, as I've mentioned earlier, Stuart Haas Racing. Tony Stewart is a part owner of that team. Tony Stewart's also a Hall of Famer, NASCAR Hall of Famer.
What's the significance of a NASCAR team? What does it mean to be on a team?
Well, so I guess I'll go with Team Penske again for an example. So drivers have teammates, so to speak. Joey Logano, Ryan Blaney, and Brad Keselowski. They all drive for Team Penske. And also teams have different manufacturer cars, I guess. So Team Penske's Ford. Joe Gibbs is Toyota. Actually, the only Toyota manufacturer in the Cup level. And Stuart Haas Racing is also Ford. Hendrick Motorsports, they're Chevy. And so, like, Joe Gibbs, teammates, Kyle Busch, Martin Truex Jr., Eric Jones, Denny Hamlin. And so, basically, I don't know. They're just like a team. Like, you know, they're sports teams. You're basically competing against every team, and each team comes up with points at the end of the season. And I should say there are teams out there like, to be honest, I don't even know all the NASCAR teams. Chip Ganassi Racing, Kurt Busch, Matt Kenseth, Front Row Motorsports, Todd Gilliland, Michael McDowell, John Hunter Nemechek, they're Ford. I made a mistake earlier. There's another Toyota team.
I knew there was no way that there's only one Toyota team.
Gaunt Brothers Racing with one driver, though, Daniel Suarez. There's also Germain Racing, Chevy with Ty Dillon. Go Fast Racing, Corey LaJoy, Ford. Hendrick, Joe Gibbs, JT Daugherty Racing.
I feel like you're like asking to lose if you name your team Go Fast.
go Fast, no T.
Oh, Fast.
Yeah. Corey LaJoy, he's actually one of my favorite racers. Definitely not one to compete with the top tier racers, but I like him as a person.
So will your teammates help you in a race?
Yeah, good question. So usually super speedway races like Talladega, Daytona, and when you're in the draft, usually teams, you will see teams match up with each other and help draft. And basically, and manufacturers as well. So you're going to have multiple teams and with the same manufacturer help on a super speedway to, you know, push your pack ahead of the other pack. So, like, it could be Fords versus Chevys usually. So you could have Roush Fenway and Team Penske work together. So
both Ford.
Correct. And then you could have, like, Hendrick Motorsports and JT Daugherty Racing help each other out. Ryan Preece, and I'll have to say JT Daugherty Racing has two of the better super speedway drivers, Ryan Preece and Ricky Stenhouse Jr. So Richard Childress also, I don't think I mentioned them. They got five drivers, Chevy group there.
Harvick races for them, correct?
No. So Harvick races for Stuart Haas.
Shoot.
It's all right.
Embarrassing.
I wouldn't expect you to know all that.
Shut up! Shut up, you idiot!
Perfect.
As you can tell, not a NASCAR expert. Ethan is...
That's all right.
Me, Ethan, not a NASCAR expert. That's why we have Ryan.
Yes, that's right. So as I was listing off all those NASCAR teams there are 17 full-time teams. What makes up a NASCAR team, right? So a team is limited to four cars in each of NASCAR's series. Teams mostly utilize one manufacturer, so Chevy, Ford, or Toyota, for all of their cars, can't be mixed. Obviously have different car numbers and crew chiefs for each driver. Different teams that share same manufacturer often work together in an alliance, like I said earlier. I should say, there are different funding groups to different NASCAR teams. So, obviously, Roger Penske and Team Penske, they have a lot of funding. So, they will basically build their stock cars maybe a little bit, you know, stronger than other teams who have limited resources. So, I know one question may pop up and say, well, how's that fair? Well, when you have a team... it's basically your responsibility to make your stock car as good as you want it to be. So that's why Michael Jordan, Denny Hamlin next season, obviously they're going to have a load of resources for Bubba Wallace and his new 23 car. So, yeah, that's why I'm excited to see Bubba Wallace and look in. That's why I think he's a potential threat for the playoffs next season. Not just his driving skills, but his new team and the co-presidents there, Denny Hamlin and Michael Jordan. So does that answer your question, Ethan?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. All right, now let's move on to, I should say, former NASCAR Cup Series driver, Kyle Larson. Most of you should know him. He was suspended over the COVID offseason after using the N-word during a iRacing event. So after that, he raced, oh man, I don't even know that league, but it's like a dirt racing league, and I think he won like 8 races in a row. So for all you Kyle Larson fans out there, good news, he's being reinstated. Yeah, so let's see what Larson has to say. So the work I've done over the last 6 months has had a major impact on me. I will make the most of this opportunity and look forward to the future. So let's see, actually. So over the year, let's see if it's... Yeah, so he was just driving on the dirt track, but Kyle Larson being reinstated. So that also, Kyle Larson was pretty, he won the All-Star race 2 years ago, and that was his only one of the season, but he's had multiple top 10 showings. Definitely a competitor and one of the younger guys out there as well. So good news for Kyle Larson, and it'll be interesting to see where he ends up in the Cup Series. We see that 88 still vacant. Also, the 20 is vacant as of now. So there's a few spots to fill, and we'll have to see where Kyle Larson will end up. So let's talk about Championship 4 now. Joey Logano, my driver, my guy, locked in. He can just coast his way through the round of 8 now. Locked in at Phoenix. That will be where the championship race will be held. So, yeah, when you introduced this segment, Ethan, you said blocking was a major word in NASCAR, and I couldn't agree more. And Joey Logano is definitely one of the better blockers out there.
Well, you want to know how I know that?
How's that?
Well, I know that because I listened to this really, really bright guy.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, his show goes a little something like this.
Okay. Hey. Sounds familiar.
Yeah, he's got this podcast,
yeah,
and it's called Drive the Greens.
Drive the Greens, yeah.
With have you heard of it?
I think so. And you know what? I think I just listened to one today. Oh, what's his name? That's me.
It's Ryan. That's right. So, listening to this most recent episode of Drive the Greens with Ryan Bentz.
Yeah,
he's not Big Bets Bentz on that
podcast. Nope.
He's only Big Bets Bentz on this podcast.
Yeah.
But he's just as insightful. And really, all I have to do is and he's got a great fact. This is a shameless plug. Do you guys know what space smells like? It's burnt steak.
Right.
You didn't know that. I didn't know that until I listened to the Drive the Greens.
Exactly. It's fascinating. Also, if you listen to my most recent one, 97% of history has been lost over time. I won't get into it now, but us modern humans, I suppose, only know 3% of history. So over the past 6,000 years, I guess, history has been documented.
So not only are you learning about NASCAR, but you're just learning about life.
Everything.
So, I mean, I'm sorry to interrupt, but, you know, I just wanted to give a quick plug about the not only entertaining, but educational.
That's right. I'm all about education.
Greens. Back to blocking.
Yes. All right. Where was I? Last weekend at Kansas Speedway, Joey Logano wasn't really running that well. Didn't receive that many stage points, but I'll have to give a shout out to his amazing pit crew. Got him out first after a pit stop. Definitely gave him the win there at the end. And Kevin Harvick, runner up. Never let up behind Joey Logano, but I mean Joey Logano was definitely racing the last 40 laps in his rearview mirror. I don't think he looked out in the front windshield at one time. And so usually drivers have preferred lines to run. So you have the low line, high line, mid line, and then you could also name those grooves. So the low groove, Joey was all over the low groove, and then Harvick was all over the high groove, so closer to the wall. And that's usually where the cars get their momentum, coming off the corner onto the straightaways. So Harvick had a ton of runs on Joey, but Joey was able to stay in front of him and then block his momentum whenever it came, and ultimately Joey won the race. So, and Kevin Harvick's words after the race, Joey's a good blocker. So
perhaps the greatest blocker in NASCAR right now.
Oh, for sure, and that also goes with his aggressiveness and wanting it more. I mean, they're racing for a championship right now.
You don't think the guy that has no money on his team because his team's broke and can't make a car as good as Team Penske, you don't think he wants it as bad as Joey?
Kevin Harvick?
That's not what I said. You said that he just wants it more. I just thought you're putting that blanket statement over all NASCAR drivers.
Oh, of course.
You're telling me that.
Well, if you want it, you got to be in the lead.
You can't.
There could be car issues, like Kurt Busch. He had an engine blown.
Who's the real NASCAR expert here? That's what I thought. That is what I thought.
All right, I see your point. I see your point. So yeah, Joey locked into the championship four. Now that takes Chase Elliott below the cutoff line, 8 points below the cutoff line. And who we see in right now, Brad Keselowski, 8 points above. Of course, Denny Hamlin and Kevin Harvick. Kevin Harvick sitting comfortably. Let's see how many points he is above. Yeah, 41 points above the cutoff line. So I wouldn't be surprised if he could win the next race. And this next race at Texas.
Yeah, tell us about Texas.
Yeah, so Texas Speedway, definitely one of my favorite tracks. Not just because it's in Texas, but usually the race winner, the trophy is a gold cowboy hat. And if you've seen any of the pictures afterwards, most recently Austin Dillon won earlier this year. He got a couple pistols in his hands wearing that gold cowboy hat, and it's just a lot of fun. So going into the Texas playoff race, we see – I'll give you a couple average finishers. Oh, I'll give you all the playoff drivers' average finishes here. So Joey Logano, 13.5, but with one win. So not Joey's best track, but enough for him to, not worry too much about it. He's obviously locked in, so he can just coast his way, kind of prepare – feel his car, Kevin Harvick, the best average finish out of the playoff drivers by a position, which is pretty good. 10.2 average finish there with about, 30 races. So he also has three wins at Texas. Denny Hamlin, 13.9 average finish. Not his best track, but he has three wins there. Chase Elliott, 11.1 average finish with zero wins. Brad Keselowski, 17.3 average finish. Not a good outing. See what he can bring this weekend. He also has zero wins at the track. Not his best track. And Martin Truex, 14 average finish, zero wins. Not his best track either. Alex Bowman, horrific 25.6 average finish, zero wins. Look for Alex Bowman to not do so well this weekend. Although he has been racing pretty well in the playoffs, you could see a top 10 finish with him, but I wouldn't expect to win. And then lastly, Kurt Busch, 14 average position with one win. But Kurt Busch, well below the cutoff line. He needs a win to advance to the championship four. So I like Kevin Harvick to do well in this race, but I'll add more to that when the Big Bentz Bets segment comes up.
Shameless plug from Big Bets Bentz for his segment coming up. That's all we got for NASCAR. After this short break, we'll get into our NFL predictions and those aforementioned Big Bets Bentz. So stick around for that segment that I'm really not very good at the picks. So we'll see how I can mess it up this week.
What's going on, Save Saturdays listeners? It's Will Reason here. Did you know that Save Saturdays isn't only a podcast? That's right. We're also on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok at Save Saturdays. Make sure to follow us for even more daily content, including fire sports memes and behind-the-scenes content from the Save Saturdays studio in Lincoln. Remember, that's at Save Saturdays on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok. And as always, Save Saturdays.
Thinking that I could have done something, but now I'm left with an empty heart. No making amends, no waking up beside you and holding you till we forget it all. How could I know there was no second?
And we are back with our third segment. Got the number right that time.
There you go.
It'll be our NFL picks.
You want to talk about it last weekend?
I do not, because I did terrible as always.
All right, well, let's do it anyways.
Well, I just want to chill.
All right.
I just want to let the viewers know that Will is not here. Yeah. But we have his picks.
Yep.
He submitted them before the show, so there's going to be no modifications. I'll give them to you. They're not very good. he's definitely going to have an Ethan type week. He's going to go 6-8 because that's apparently all I can do.
Hey, yeah, that's what you went last week.
Yeah, I went 6-8 the first week, went 6-8 this week. So since we've actually been going back and keeping track, I'm rocking a sick 12-16 record.
Yeah.
Certainly not a pro gambler here.
I'll have to boast about mine real quick. I went 8-6 last weekend. So that I think that combines me to 17-9. So not too shabby. Will, though, 7-7 last weekend.
I think he's got 16 right so 17. Far. 17?
Yeah, 17 and 10, I think.
There's no way he got 10 right in the first week. I thought he only got 9.
No, because I got 9, I think.
All right, well, either way, you know who's near the bottom and who's at the top.
That's right.
Me at the bottom, everyone else at the top. But we're gonna keep going.
Yep.
We're going to show a little resilience, something that Aaron Rodgers doesn't understand. And I'm just going to go ahead and attack this week, you know.
Let's do it.
So, Thursday night football for the record, Giants versus the Eagles. I'm taking the Eagles.
Yeah, Eagles.
Who's Will taking? Who's Will taking?
What are you taking, Will? Eagles?
Is he?
I don't know.
It's right there on the sheet.
Oh.
It's in parentheses, dog.
I thought you were playing with me here. Giants.
He's taking the Giants.
Ooh, upset of the week.
I think he did tease us. He's like, there's going to be an upset on there.
First game.
He's a Joe Judge guy, so I'm not surprised by that at all. Okay. I guarantee that's why he's pegged the Giants to win that game.
All right.
A matchup of the top two teams in the AFC, Steelers-Titans.
Oh, yeah.
I'm taking the Titans.
I got to take the Titans, too.
Who's Will taking?
The Titans, of course.
So we're taking Titans across the board.
Yes, sir.
Cowboys versus the Washington football team. Yeah, I'm gonna be honest. I made these picks last week, what a horrible game! Like, what a horrible game to pick. I don't like.
Don't tell me this is America's game of the week.
This better not be America's game of the week. Side note here.
Yeah.
Cowboys being bad this year has saved America from having to repetitively watch Cowboys games. Yep. The last two to three years with Dak, every game of the week is a Cowboys game.
Right.
It's aggravating. Yeah, I understand that. I understand they're doing it for the money, yep. But
America's team.
Man, that is just brutal. It's brutal. I'm going to take the Cowboys.
Interesting. Interesting.
There's not a lot to like in Washington, but there's not a lot to like in Dallas either.
Yeah, I'd have to go with the Cowboys as well. If they get Zeke in that running game, I think Cowboys should go on top there.
Who's Will taking?
Oh, the football team.
Yeah, I don't blame him.
Yeah, yeah.
Bills, Jets. Bills.
Bills. Bills.
Yeah, that, I didn't expect much.
No, against the Jets, come on.
Yeah. Panthers, Saints, I'm taking the Panthers.
I like the Saints in this game.
Will's taking the Panthers, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Man,
I like these matchups.
My boy.
You two versus Ryan, I usually do well in those matchups, so.
He likes it so much, he's compelled to talk in the third person. I also did it early in the show, so I'm not going to be too hard on him.
You know, I think there's a game we should do a bye bet on.
Yeah, you like that?
I do.
So how many? You just want to do one?
No, we could do...
I'm in a little bit of a Bob deficit right now, so...
One it is.
I was going to say I'd do two, but...
That's all right.
All right, one. Packers-Texans. Packers get a pretty easy rebound game here against the bumbling and fumbling Texans.
Yeah.
I'm going to take the Packers.
Packers as well.
Will?
Packers.
I didn't expect... You know, he's a loose cannon, so yeah. I thought maybe Texans.
Maybe.
But glad to hear that he's got his brain is working right every once in a while. Browns, Bengals. This game?
It's going to be a good game.
It's going to be a good game. Bengals, they're rising. Joe Burrow, he's on the up. Big Browns take a big, tough, bad-looking loss last week to the Steelers. Yeah. Really didn't look like they understood how to play football for majority of that game. Baker Mayfield has not looked worse this season. But I'm going to take the Browns.
Oh, wow. Not expecting that. I'm taking the Bengals, and so is Will.
I'll put a Bob on that.
All right. I like that.
Only with Ryan. Will cannot make Bob bets when he's not here.
Fair enough.
Lions versus the Falcons. Falcons with a big, big win. Finally got Julio Jones a touchdown. Right. Is that offense clicking? Probably not. But the Lions are... worse. Lions have even less talent to like on that team, so I'm going to be taking the Atlanta Falcons.
Falcons with me as well, and Will will also take the Falcons.
Seahawks versus the Cardinals. Cardinals with a resounding win against the Cowboys last week. They have a lot of talent to like, but I'm going to have to take the Seahawks because my boy, my MVP, Russell Wilson, he's just going to have it. He's just going to have it going.
All right. I like the Seahawks too, and actually Will is taking the Cardinals.
What a maniac. I'd put a Bob on that if he's here. Jags versus the Chargers. Little mini man Minshew versus big boy Justin Herbert. Big Justin, if I can take a little bit from Gus Johnson. Saying that. Big Sam. Big Justin.
Yeah, really. Yeah.
I got the Chargers. I love the Chargers. Justin Herbert has been robbed repetitively. Refs suck in that Chargers game. I'm taking the Chargers. He's going to get that win. He's a good quarterback. And there's no way Tua gets his first win before Justin gets his first win. So it's going to be the Chargers.
Jags.
Get out of here with this Minshew. Disgust.
I like this matchup.
What is this obsession? It's because
he's got a mustache.
Yeah, you guys both have mustaches.
I can't compete with that, but I'm getting there.
Who's Will taking? If it's the Jags...
The Chargers.
Thank goodness. I was about to go into the second story of this apartment building.
Oh, well, I like the Jags. So.
That's despicable. Right. I'll put a Bob on that.
I thought you were in a deficit.
Yeah, I'm not going to throw five on one game, but I'll spread my wealth a little, poverty a little bit.
All right, understandable.
I'm not going to spend all three of my pennies on one piece of bread. I'm going to buy three croutons with one penny each. Sustains me for three meals. 49ers versus the Pats. I'm going to be taking the Patriots. And, I still don't think it's going to be time for Panic City in Santa Clara. Right. But I'm liking the Patriots in this game.
Me too.
And Will's definitely taking the Patriots.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can't imagine that kid ever picking against his team. No. Chiefs, Broncos. Broncos with a big win against the Patriots. Patriots team who... You could argue if they had Cam, could have beaten this Kansas City team, but this will be the first game we see Le'Veon Bell with KC. Mm-hmm. I'm taking the Chiefs.
Chiefs and Chiefs.
Buccaneers versus the Raiders. I thought the Buccaneers would be coming off a loss when I made this pick, so I have the Raiders. I'm going to stick with the Raiders. Buccaneers might have a little bit of a hangover. They've looked beatable. They lost to the Bears. Was that a wake-up call that they're just going to go on a tear
now? After a blowout against Green Bay?
Might lull them a little bit. Raiders are sneaky.
Okay. Yeah, I can agree with that.
They're slick. So I'm gonna take the Raiders.
I like the Bucks against the Raiders, and Will does too.
Of course, of course.
Yeah, of course.
And then Monday Night Football matching up Bears versus the Rams. We only have one Monday Night Football game this week.
Really? That's unheard of.
Pretty much anymore in the COVID season. We're having games on Tuesdays now. But yeah, so far, as of right now, as of Thursday, October 22nd at 5:35 p.m., there's only one Monday Night Football game. If that changes,
I'm not surprised.
Honestly. But right now, only game, Bears-Rams. Bears are pretenders.
Yeah.
There's a joke that they've only lost one game. Buccaneers were doing something that wasn't playing football when they played the Bears. So I'm going to be taking the Rams. Much better team there. I'm not going to say better coached, but Jared Goff,
yeah,
this might be the only time they have the quarterback advantage, the Rams, because Jared Goff has not looked good over the last couple of years, after the last year and a half, I'd say.
Yeah, but after that Super Bowl loss.
But Nick Foles and Trubisky are certainly both worse than Goff, so I'm going to take the Rams.
Rams with me.
And Will?
Rams.
All right, good. Good. Glad to see we're all bright young men.
Yeah.
And now, the moment you've all been waiting for.
Let's hear it.
It's been teased multiple times. You know it. It's consistent. It's every week.
Yeah.
It's your Big Bets Bentz of the Week. Ryan, take it away.
You got it. Thank you for that. Another amazing intro. Never get old. Bets of the week. I'll start with some NFL. So, as you've heard earlier in this podcast, we've set our picks. You've seen the matchups. So now let's go a little more in depth here. Sunday, Browns Bengals. A good game. Browns are picked by 3. Ethan probably likes that. But I like the Bengals in this game. And I think to win outright.
Well, obviously, because if they cover.
You win nothing if they cover because it's +3.
Right, and you pick them to win the game, so of course you're going to pick them to outright.
Of course, yeah.
I would take them to cover. I don't think they're going to win. I think like a one-point game.
Okay, all right.
24-23. Yeah,
so Bengals solid bet there. Cowboys, Washington football team. A pick game. So
really, that should tell you all you need to know about Mike McCarthy in Dallas is that
right.
The Washington football team with Alex Smith, who could very possibly not have one of his legs right now if the doctors in Washington weren't exceptional, starting at quarterback, and it's a pick 'em game with Dallas. That should be all you need to know. Go ahead, Ryan.
That's right. Yeah, so obviously my pick before. I said Cowboys, right? I said Cowboys. Yeah, Cowboys. So, I don't know. Maybe that's a game you'd want to stay away from. I wouldn't blame you. Maybe you can do the over-under. Total score, 46. Probably go under. Definitely under there. I could see it being like a 2017 game. So, what else? Ooh. Oh, here's one that I like. Panthers-Saints. Saints by 7.5. That's a crazy spread. I might have to go with the Panthers just to cover. I know I said I like the Saints to win, and I think they're still going to win, but maybe by 3 or 4. So, Panthers there with the spread. Packers-Texans. Wow. Packers -3.5. Let's bet on the Packers there.
That is a lot closer than I would have predicted it.
Yeah?
Yeah. Really? I was thinking maybe you'd say, like, you were saying, wow, because the Packers were favored by like 13 points. And I was like, yeah, that's probably an under, but yeah. 3.5, that's an over.
That's an over for sure.
Hammer the over on that.
Another good game we talked about, Steelers-Titans. Both undefeated. Titans are picked by 1.5. I like that bet. I like that bet. After Ryan Tannehill, Derrick Henry, they seem to be clicking really well together. Look for the Titans to get that win there at home as well. 49ers-Patriots. Patriots by 2. Over. Definitely over. And 49ers injury prone there. Not looking great. Patriots for sure. Oh, man. Chiefs-Broncos. Chiefs by 10. I'd say so. I'd say Chiefs by 10. Let's see. Sunday night football. Seahawks-Cardinals. Seahawks by 3. Honestly, that's a game I'd stay away from. But do what you will. That game's over under 56 points. That's a lot of points. I would say under if you'd want to do that. But that's up to you. I'd say that's a bet that I will leave up to you all. All right. Now, Monday Night Football. Bears and Rams. Rams by 6, and I like this bet. Rams by 6. Do it. That's a good one. All right. That's your NFL for you. Now let's shift gears to NASCAR. All right. Love to hear it. No pun intended. I'm just kidding. So I'll give you the full field here. Let's change things up a bit here. So Cole Custer. All right, driving that 41 car, 101 odds, stay away. Christopher Bell, 101 odds, stay away. Matt Kenseth, 101 odds, stay away. Matt DiBenedetto, 65-1 odds. His best finish at Texas is 14th, and that was last year's race. Stay away. Clint Bowyer, 40-1 odds. Best finish second, and that was twice. Most recently, last spring race. He's my sleeper again for this week. I love Clint Bowyer. This is last full season as well, so look for Clint Bowyer to run well at Texas. Jimmy Johnson, 40-1. Best finish first 7 times. Jimmy Johnson, winner at Texas 7 times. Most recently, spring of 2017. He could be a contender, but by the way, his season has been running this year. Stay away from Jimmy. Unfortunately, I know, I hate to say it, but, you know, I hope Jimmy wins this race, but, if you're betting, don't bet on Jimmy. William Byron, odds, 40-1, best Texas finish, 6th, last year, stay away. Austin Dillon, opening odds, 40-1, best finish, 1st of this year, this spring, Texas race. He's a good, solid driver at Texas. He's another sleeper of mine. I think he has the potential to win this race. Tyler Reddick, 35-1, best finish 2nd of this year as well. So, yeah, Tyler Reddick finished runner-up to Austin Dillon. They were really battling out for the lead there. So Tyler Reddick has potential as well, but don't bet on Reddick this weekend. Alex Bowman, 35-1, a playoff driver. Best Texas finish is 5th. And his only top 10 out of 10 races. So stay away from Alex Bowman this weekend as well. Eric Almirola in that 10 car, 25-1. Best Texas finish, 2nd of last year. I like Eric, but not to win. Kurt Busch, 20-1. He's another playoff driver. His best finish was 1st 11 years ago. He desperately needs a win in this round to make it to the championship 4. So look for Kurt to be competitive, but I don't think he's going to cross that line, number 1. Eric Jones, 18-1. His best finish, 4th, and that was 3 times, most recently of last year. Driver of the number 20 Toyota. Definitely could be in the top 10, but don't look for him to win. Stay away from Eric Jones, Brad Keselowski, playoff driver. 16-1, best Texas finish, second, and that was twice, most recently in 2015. As I said earlier, a poor average finish, I think around 17, stay away from Brad. Kyle Busch, 12-1, he is out of the playoffs. So he's finished, his best Texas finish is first three times, most recently of spring of 2018. Look for Kyle to bounce back after a winless season and maybe get that win this weekend at Texas. Ryan Blaney, odds 11-1, best finish, second. So he hasn't won here. You know, I really like Blaney. He's got a really strong car this whole season. I like Blaney to win. And let's see here. Truex Jr., 10-1, best finish, second. Never won. Chase Elliott, never won, best finish, fourth. His odds, 10-1. Joey Logano, my guy, recent winner at Kansas Speedway. Locked himself in the Final Four. I know I've said that so many times today, but I'm just so excited. His odds, 7-1. Best finish, first at 2014. Joey, look for Joey to just have a nice, relaxing race, not for him to do too much. So Denny Hamlin, odds 5-1, first place three times, most recently of last spring, 2019. Hamlin should have one heck of a race this weekend. And finally, Kevin Harvick, 13-5 odds. That's amazing odds. Obviously the favorite. Him and Denny Hamlin, obviously the two favorites. Kevin Harvick's best finish, first three times recently of last year. So look for Denny Hamlin and Kevin Harvick to battle it out. Battle out for the win at Texas. I believe that is all I have for you today. I hope you enjoyed my segment. Get out there and get your bets on.
And as always, the big Bets Bentz of the week will conclude our show. So be sure to check out not only Big Bentz's show,
Drive the Greens with Ryan Bentz.
Drive the Greens. That airs every Wednesday.
Yes, sir.
At 2 p.m. As does all of our shows, 2 p.m. usually every day. Obviously, you're saying, hey, Ethan, it's Thursday, and it's you just said it was 5:30, and you know that no show came out at 2. And that's on Will. But we're going to give him a pass because he's been going home. He's been splitting time between Lincoln and Giltner, Nebraska, wintering his family's cattle for the year. So we'll be sure to hit you guys with Boston Bias. As you already know, because the show comes out after that, we'll be hitting you guys with an episode of Boston Bias and Safe Saturdays U, which has a new logo. So be sure to check out the Safe Saturdays U show, which will air every Friday at 2 p.m. I'm the host of that. And also Offsides with Ethan Petrick and Take Out Tuesday, also wearing it too on Tuesdays. So be sure to check out all of our other shows, and always remember to
save Saturdays.